Hello, I'm glad to be here in the reclojure conference online. My name is Jonathan Charvit, and I'm gonna talk about data-oriented programming, which is the secret sauce that makes Clojure systems less complex. And as a sauce for spaghetti, a tasty sauce for spaghetti, you might use it with spaghetti or with many kind of pasta. And one of the purpose of my talk is to reveal you the secrets of Clojure, of data-oriented programming in Clojure, so that you can, on one hand, have a better understanding of them, and also you would be able to apply this secret and use it in other programming languages, even in Java. Okay, so before we dive into data-oriented programming, let's see what usually people love in Clojure. What is the essence of Clojure? Or what are the main big features that make Clojure development so fun and productive? We have four main axes. The fact that Clojure is homoiconic, the fact that it's functional, the REPL, of course, and the fact that Clojure is data-oriented. So let's see very briefly what benefits each big feature gives to us, the developers. First of all, the fact that Clojure is homoiconic, that the syntax of the language is the same as the syntax of the data, makes it easy to and possible to extend the language via macros. And we can take the language, there is no limits to the power of expression the language can give us. Also, we are able to navigate the code and edit it in a structural way. While in other languages, we navigate the code in terms of characters and lines, and it's much more productive to navigate the code structurally. The second big feature is the fact that Clojure embraces functional programming and it gives us lots of power of expression. That's not unique to Clojure, but that's a big one. The third one is the REPL. How would we develop in Clojure without the REPL? The only problem with the REPL is that you are addicted. You become addicted to it, and when you are in other language with no REPL, I don't want to say nightmare, but it's much less fun. The REPL allows us to explore code in isolation, to experiment, to get a very short feedback loop, and we are very, 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 very expressive. In a sense, the program becomes an extension of our fingers as we type in the keyboard. And finally, the fourth big feature in Clojure is the fact that it's data-oriented. And that's the topic of our talk today. And the main benefit that data-oriented programming gives us is that it reduces the complexity of our systems. The complexity not in terms of performance, CPU, memory, the time it takes to run the program, the resources it consumes, but complexity in terms of how hard it is to understand the system for a human being. And there is no doubt that I hope you would agree with me that a program, a system written in Clojure, it's much, much, much easier to understand for a human being than a program written in Java. And the insight I'd like to convey is that what makes Clojure simple, in a sense, easy to understand, is because it is data oriented. Because it is data oriented, the system is simpler. That's the main claim of our talk today. So what does it mean? What do I mean really by data oriented programming? By data-oriented programming, in a sense, if I want to get to the gist of it, is that data is, in our program, a first-class citizen. Similar to the fact that in a functional programming, functions are first-class citizens, in a data-oriented program, data is a first-class citizen. And we'll see in details what it means to be a first-class citizen, what it means for data to be a first-class citizen. Basically, it turns around three main principles that we are going to dive in the talk. The first principle of data-oriented programming is that we separate between code and data. We don't encapsulate data inside code or code and data together inside classes or lexical scope or whatever. That's principle number one. Principle number two is that we represent data with generic data structures, not with classes or algebraic tabs or whatever. We represent data with generic data structures. As you may guess, by generic data structure in this context, I mean basically a hash map. The third and last principle is that we never ever mutate data. Data is a value that never changes. So that's the three principles. And what I like about these principles is that, first of all, they are language agnostic. You might be in a functional programming language and you can break any of those three principles. On the other hand, you might be in an object-oriented language, in an OO language like Java, and you might adhere and respect any one of those three principles. In a statically typed language like Java, C Sharp, or Go, we might say that it's less natural to apply those three principles, especially principle number two, about the way we represent data, but we can adhere to principle number two even in a statically typed language. And we can break any of those principles in a dynamically typed language. So, to make a long story short, the principles are language agnostic. And in Clojure, in a sense, the language, I don't want to say force, but guides us strongly to respect those three principles. But once we understand them, once we they are part of our developing habit, we are able to take them and implement them into other languages. It could be JavaScript, in Java, Ruby, C Sharp, or whatever. Another thing to note is that each principle is applicable in isolation. You might respect principle number one and break principle number two, or respect principle number three and break principle number one. They are applicable in isolation, and each of them brings its own benefit. Of course, if you embrace the three of them as a whole, then you get a really, really powerful system. Okay, so in order to make things a bit more concrete, I'm going to illustrate in the context of a library management system each of those three principles. So let's say you are hired by a customer and you need to design a library management system. If you are in a classic OO language, Java or C Sharp, you might probably come with a design and a class diagram that looks like this piece of art. I'm ironic. This UML diagram with arrows and classes and relations and different kind of classes is probably well known to you if you have ever developed in any OO language. And in my opinion, systems built with this kind of diagram of class hierarchies are complex. What makes such a system complex? Let's take a look at this diagram at a very high level without going into the details of what is a librarian, what are the fields, what are the members, what are the methods, just at a high level. You may observe that we have nodes, classes with many, many edges. Take a look, for example, at the librarian node. It has 6 edges connected to it. A node with many edges and dependencies is complex in the sense that it's hard to understand what this node, this class does, and what is going to happen if you modify a bit the code of the class in order to adapt to a change in the requirements, for example. Another thing that you may observe in this diagram is that you have many kind of arrows, 4 of them. You have the association arrows with the empty diamonds. You have composition arrows with the plain diamond. You have inheritance, the plain arrows, and you have usage arrows for dashed arrows for usage. Even without remembering exactly your basic UML from college or school or whatever, it's complicated. It's difficult to remember all those dependencies, to grasp them, to decide whether you need association or composition, and inheritance or composition, and the system is entangled. Many things are mixed together, and it makes it, for us human being, hard to reason about the system. It makes the systems complex. So now, we'll see that if we apply principle number 1 that guides us to separate code from data, we are going to reduce the complexity of the system. So again, to make things very, very concrete, what do I mean by separating code from data? I mean that code lives in modules or classes or whatever, but it's only code, only functions, only methods, stateless functions, with no data encapsulation. So you have the code modules, and you have the data entities that are made only from members. Again, no code. So you have a clear separation between code and data. How it might look like, for example, when we break this principle in a, let's say in JavaScript with its FP, its functional flavor, you might, for example, how we might implement the author object. We might create a function, create author, that receives a first name and last name and returns an object that exposes one single method named full name, and this method accesses from the lexical scope, from the closure, the members that were passed to the constructor. So if you do that, even if you are in FP, you break principle number 1. And you might break it even in closure. If you add a method to a record, you break principle number 1. On the other hand, you might write your code in JavaScript in the OO flavor of JavaScript. And if you have a data class with members only, the author data here, and a static class name calculation, for instance, with a single static method that accesses the data not from the closure, but from the parameters passed explicitly to the function, then you adhere to principle number 1 that guides us to separate clearly between code and data. So what do we gain when we separate code from data? We reduce the complexity of the system. Let me show you how it looks like. So here is our original class diagram. And if we split each class into a static class with code, or a static class or a class with static functions only, or modules or whatever, and data, then what happens? It happens something very interesting. We have on the left side the class diagram of the static classes, modules, and on the right side we have the data only, with a D here, a pink D. And this, because the system is now split, then each part is much, much, much easier to grasp, to understand, to reason about, to modify, etc. We have a clear separation of concerns. We have code concerns and we have data concerns. And when we deal with code, we deal only with code. And when we deal with data, we deal only with data. And we have constraints on the code diagram, because then on our code entities, our modules, static classes, whatever, the only relationships between code entities are usage relationships. We have no inheritance, no association, no composition. It's much, 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 it makes the code diagram or the class diagram that of the code entities very easy to understand, or at least easier to understand. And on the other hand, on the right side, the data are only, the connection between data are only either association or composition. And it's an inherent part of your business, of your the problem that you solve. I mean, if a book has many authors and an author has many books, then there is a many-to-many relationships between the book data and the author data. It's inherent to the problem we solve. In a sense, we have sticked to the inherent complexity of the problem we are trying to solve. And simply separating between code and data makes a huge difference in terms of simplicity of the system. Okay, now principle number two, we represent data with generic data structures. What does it mean? It means that basically we have three kinds of data, let's say data collections or data aggregation entities. We have indexes, we have collections, and we have records. Indexes and collections, we represent them like in any other languages, nothing special here in DO, in data oriented. The big surprise, the big opinion comes with records. As in Clojure, we model our informations, our records, with maps, heterogeneous maps. Here, by record, I mean record as a general concept of software engineering, not record in Clojure. So here, in Clojure, records are, according to data-oriented programming, records should be modeled as maps. Why heterogeneous maps? Because the values in the map might be of different types. You might have, for example, let's say a book with a title which is a string, a publishing date which is an integer, and a collection of author which is a collection. So it's heterogeneous. So let's see how it looks like. Again, first see how we break the principle, and then we'll see how we adhere to the principle. So if we define a rigid class named book here to instantiate, for example, Watchman book with the class constructor, we break the principle. Why do we break the principle? Because this class is not generic. It's specific to our code. On the other hand, if we just instantiate the Watchman book with a hash map, we adhere to the principle. Why is it beneficial? Is that in a sense, it allows us to reduce the complexity even more, because generic data structures like hash maps are highly flexible. You can add a field to a hash map. You can remove a field from a hash map. You can rename a field in a hash map. You can, so that makes them highly flexible. And also, the code is simpler because we can manipulate hash map with generic functions. We can retrieve the keys of a hash map. We can rename several keys of a hash map, which just a function, as the many functions we have in the Clojure core namespace. In terms of the complexity reduction, principle number one allows us to simplify the diagram and have two simple sub-diagrams instead of the unified diagram that we had from OO. When we adhere to principle number two, when we represent record and data in general with generic data structures, then the right part, the right diagram, becomes implicit in our system. It's not explicit. And the dependency between the code, let's say inside the catalog code, the dependency between the catalog code and the catalog data is a weak dependency. The only thing that matters to any piece of code inside the catalog module is the names of the fields in the catalog data. The names only, and names are strings. We can manipulate them generically. So of course, to write code inside the catalog module, you need to know what are the name of the fields in the catalog data. But this knowledge is documented in the code, in a diagram, whatever. But my point here is that the code depends weakly, is less coupled to the data. If you are, for example, in an O language, on the left side, before you separate, if you represent data with classes, in order to manipulate the catalog data class inside the catalog code, you need to import the definition of the catalog data. It makes our system rigid. Once data is represented by generic data structures, the dependency becomes weak, as I said before, and the system is much more flexible. Another benefit that we gain when we represent data with generic data structures is that we are able to visualize in our program the whole data of the system. You might, for example, take the catalog and print it in the REPL, store it in a file, send it over the wire. It's just data. Serialize it to JSON. And it's highly beneficial. The fact that data is data, that will represent it as it is, with no additional ceremony, with no additional constructs, programmatic construct, makes our program more directly connected to the data, and in this sense, makes it simpler. Each piece of information in our system has a path. For example, the name of the author, Alan Moore, has this path: catalog, author by ID, Alan Moore, name, it's here. Each piece of information is accessible via its path. And also you get reflection for free. You don't need reflection in order to inspect all the fields at once of a record, like you might need if you represent a record with a class. Principle number two is the one that Rich Hickey talks about it so much and in such a beautiful way. Mutation causes so many problems. Avoid mutation as much as you can. And it also reduces the complexity of our system. Okay, so that were the three principles of data-oriented programming. I hope you get a better understanding of what you probably feel intuitively after a couple of months in programming in Clojure. Of course, it's not perfect. We lose. There is a price that we need to pay in when we apply those principles. There is less compile time check. There are other the fact that the code and the data are not encapsulated together makes it sometimes a bit more difficult to understand which piece of code manipulates which piece of data. There is a price. But my purpose today was to emphasize the benefits that we gain. And we take them for granted in Clojure. And what I'd like you to take as an outcome of this talk is that you can apply each of the three principles, or the three of them as a whole, in any language. If you are in a dynamically typed language, JavaScript, Ruby, Python, then the only thing that you need is a data manipulation library and a minimutation library that implements persistent data structure. If you are in a statically typed language, you need also a data manipulation library and immutable library. There are libraries for them in any language, in C#, in Go, in Java. There is something that is a bit cumbersome, is that sometimes when you access a record, when you access a field in a record via the information path, if you need to manipulate the value, let's say it's a string, for example, and you want to uppercase it, before manipulating it, you need to do a static cast to a string. So that's a bit cumbersome in a statically typed language. Let's summarize the three principles that I summarized succinctly in this mind map. We have our system, we split between code and data. The code could be written in FP, in OOP, doesn't matter. And the data should be generic, represented by generic data structures and immutable. Okay, that was I'm almost done. And now I hope it was not too hard to grasp. It was a bit theoretical. So in order to make the end of the talk more enjoyable to you, I'm gonna play a song, a famous song, with slightly modified lyrics. Feel free to sing with John Lennon. John Lennon used to love data. Take your guitar at home and start singing. Someday, O will join us. Okay, basically I'm done. I hope you enjoyed the talk. Unfortunately, I'm not here to answer your questions. I'm sure you have plenty of questions. Feel free to send me an email, to chat on Twitter, to give feedback to the talk about the principles, the data oriented programming principles, the way we leverage them in Clojure, the way we can leverage them in any other language. And actually, I'm currently writing a book for Manning where about data-oriented programming, where I explore in details those principles. Feel free to register here, leave your email, and you will be notified once the book is published. I wish you a great conference. I hope you will enjoy the other talks. Take care, keep safe.